Pursuit of Battle Angel is about a girl who is plopped into the world not knowing who she is or what she is.
Do you know who I am?
We were hoping you'd fill in that part.
She thinks she's just an insignificant girl, so she goes on this journey in order to find out who she is and discover what she is, and discovers that she's not an insignificant girl at all. She is someone actually quite extraordinary.
She represents, I think, a certain kind of female empowerment that we need in films. It's an empowerment of her internal psychological and spiritual character. I like Alita because she's absolutely fearless. It doesn't matter how big the opponent is or how powerful or how menacing, she just goes right at it.
If anybody asks me about the timing of making Alita, it's not the technology that was so important. It was finding Rosa Salazar to play the character of Alita.
Rosa Salazar is fantastic. I mean, she is our greatest asset, I think, on this movie.
It's amazing when you're doing casting and you're hoping the actor walks in and it's the character. It's a real gift when that happens, and it just so happened that way on this.
Rosa came in and auditioned for Robert, and he said to us that Rosa actually made him cry.
She ran the gamut of it in such a way that I was totally affected.
Don't do this. Don't leave me down here. Not for that.
I kind of put together several scenes so you could see them, from the innocent little girl to the love scene with the boy meeting him, some father-daughter scenes, and then her realizing who she is.
And ultimately, we set up an old-fashioned screen test.
I don't mean to be rude, but am I supposed to know you?
And when we just watched the footage back on the big screen, there was no question of who was born to play Alita, other than Rosa Salazar.
And she just started to emerge out in front of everybody. An actor who put such heart, such emotion, and such vitality into every moment.
You're the only one who sees me for who I really am. Or the same, Hugo.
It was the best gift we could have gotten, and it's the kind of gift you're still very thankful for. This would have been so difficult. Otherwise, her humanity comes out, and she emotes so well that it makes the character super relatable. You have to believe in this character and believe she exists. And it's just realer than real.
Starting to feel like I wasn't very important. Just an insignificant girl thrown out with the rest of the garbage.
When we gave Rosa the part, it was a good 5 to 6 months before we went into production. And Rosa, from that day forward, dedicated herself to playing Alita. She trained in martial arts. She trained in rollerblading. She trained whenever we asked her to do anything.
Oh, that did look good.
When I walked in there for the first time, I was made out of croissants. So I was not her yet. A lot of it was getting the endurance up, toning my body, changing my diet, becoming a very regimented person. And it was great for the character because Alita was trained as a warrior. She has a warrior's mind, she has a warrior's body, she has a warrior's endurance. The training almost killed me. I worked really closely for 4.5 months with Keith Cook Hirabayashi, who is a very, very talented martial artist. We did 2 hours every day. We did a lot of kicks. We did a lot of Muay Thai. We did a lot of Kung Fu, Eagle Claw. We did kickboxing.
When she came in, she was this whirlwind. She wanted to do everything herself. She didn't want to just go in there and have to look good for camera. She wanted to be good for martial artists.
From skating to fighting, the poses to reactions, we wanted to make her action second nature so that she could just focus on her character, and then the reactions and the body movement would have been just there.
So she went over there and she learned weapons, she learned open hand combat, she learned all sorts of other things. Everyone had to get their rollerblade 101 down. Rosa did a great job.
It takes a lot of girls to bring Alita to life. It takes about 9 girls. I'm doing all of the acting and I'm doing what I can do martial arts-wise. But then there are other girls who take it from there, who can twirl through the air 6 times, who can contort their bodies because they've been doing it since birth. They really take it to the next level.
biggest challenge of this film from a design standpoint was the character of Alita herself.
We take a lot of the design straight from the book. And the look of Alita straight from the book.
Alita in our movie has three bodies. She starts out in what we call the doll body, and that is a body that is about innocence and how Alita first comes into this world. We went through a very lengthy design process of the character, and that enabled us to get into great detail on her initial body with the porcelain inlays and all the detail that Ito spent in preparing the body for his daughter.
Robert had a specific vision of a piece of alabaster pottery that he'd seen. The way that the light came through it and the way that the surface texture was.
It was luminous.
It was luminous and it was beautiful.
The doll body was a huge design exercise unto itself. This body is the one made by Ito. He's almost like a Swiss watchmaker. He's invested this with all kinds of beautiful detail. There's etching and filigree and engraving all over the body. And it just conveys the love that Ito felt for his daughter that he now is sort of conferring onto Alita as he puts her into this body.
This is called a berserker. It's a humanoid weapon system created by the Urm Technarchy.
This is Alita's other body, the berserker body.
A warrior spirit deserves a warrior's body. And you realize that this body was completely made for her.
Alita and her berserker body come from Urm technology. That is why Ito doesn't understand it. That's why when she finds a berserker body, it's unlike anything anyone has seen or anyone that has seen in 300 years.
Urm is the United Republic of Mars. Mars had been colonized. There were battles across the galaxy between Mars and Earth. And she lived in that time 300 years ago.
It has some kind of nanomusculature. It's probably electrically driven under the hood, but the actual actuation is much more organic. It's much more like a sort of living metal sort of muscle suit.
It's the adaptive technology of the berserker body. The shell is reconfiguring to her subconscious image of herself. I've never seen anything like it.
The idea is that she's tough as nails. You know, all of these things that look like muscle and sinew could probably take a bullet if they had to. Here we have a back view of the body, how the panels and muscles flow that Vitaly came up with. It's stunning. It's really great. And at the same time relates to the manga. She still has her signature metal side of her upper arm that has the ventilation holes in it. And you know, we tried to keep it something that was inspired by some of her chromier bodies in the manga.
I'm a lot more touch sensitive too. A lot higher density of force feedback.
You can feel this?
Yes.
A big story point is that Hugo takes her hand and actually feels the touch receptors that she has. So we kind of came up with this contrast between metal surfacing and this kind of gel that serves as the kind of fat pad of your hand and of all of your different fingertips. And if I zoom in here, you can even see that the fingertips themselves have specific little touch pads.
99! On your left!
At the end of the movie, Alita's core is put into a special body designed for Motorball. And she comes out in the track with a number from her past. Because in her past, we have learned that she was soldier number 99. And that's what soldiers were. They were just numbers. But Alita's more than a number. But to recognize her past, she carries proudly the number 99.
Let's hear it for the Battle Angel herself, number 99, Alita!
I knew when I did Avatar with Weta that Alita would not only be possible, that as a character, she would be spectacular.
I love it.
Every time we do these hero characters, we try and make them an evolution of our technology at Weta.
In Alita's eyeball alone, there's more geometry than all of Gollum for Lord of the Rings.
We followed Rose's performance and used that as our goalpost for what we wanted Alita to be doing in her performance.
The reason we choose performance capture instead of keyframing is in any digital character's performance, we're looking to bring life to that character. And there's no better way of doing that than capturing a performance from a real human.
The way the performance capture process worked is we had a number of cameras placed around the set that would record markers on the actor's physical body. Based on what one camera would see and what another camera wouldn't see, the system would interpret that marker and put it into three-dimensional space. Furthermore, it would know enough markers on the body to do what we call a biomechanical solve and create a skeleton to go inside a CG model to drive that CG model's performance.
This body, it has the power I need. I feel a connection to it. I can't explain. This could be who I am.
Felita is completely CG. Rosa Salazar is in a performance capture suit all the time in this movie.
It takes some getting used to. You're wearing a helmet with mic pack, battery, microphone, a titanium boom, two cameras. You're zipped into the suit. You're Velcroed in at the feet, and you have gloves. So basically anything they could do to you to obstruct your process, they've done.
What changes it from being motion capture to performance capture is that simultaneously with capturing the body's performance, we are capturing the facial performance. Weta would interpret those images on a frame by frame, almost on a pore by pore level, to drive the facial performance of the character of Alita. Capturing the performance of an actress or an actor in a CG character, you need great people with great eyes to look at performances. We have our secret weapon at Lightstorm, Richie Bainham. Richie, who won an Academy Award for Avatar, will look at these animation passes. There's no lighting in the shot. It's a grayscale figure of Alita. And he will look at the details of the nasal labia fold, and he'll talk about that in very specifics. He'll talk about the muscles under the skin driving the subtleties of a teardrop coming out of an eye.
The real breakthrough with Alita's face was to take Rosa and track her onto a character version, an actor puppet, which is essentially a real-time visual representation of Rosa's face. From there, understanding, working backwards to what muscles are firing in which order and making sure we vet ourselves to say Rosa's performance is coming through on Rosa, then you can take and manipulate that and apply it to Alita. I think that's a big breakthrough.
Where am I now?
With me.
When you talk about something like representation of manga, we really wanted to be able to take this augmented animation hybrid and layer it against the performance capture.
In this particular instance, we did some motion capture, but it was too realistic. How do you blend in the manga of her flying through the air and all that stuff? So we decided to augment everything. So we made her jump a little higher, we slow motioned her, always to get closer to the manga.
When a stunt performer for Alita is performing, Rosa will be on the side, walking through the performance, but giving us a facial performance that we can use as well.
She would go through a simple version of the stunt, and we would capture her facial, her head movement, and then we would use the stuntee's movement for her body. So you get the best of both worlds. Get her!
Rosa has a particularly interested in physiognomy. Her facial muscles and the way she manipulates them is very different than a lot of other actresses. And it was very important for us to try retain that all the way through. With Rosa, she has a very, very specific rhythm to how her muscles fire. I think that understanding which muscles fire in which order was kind of one of the real goals to bring Alita to life. And hopefully we've done that.
I'd give you whatever I have.
What are you doing?
I'd give you my heart. Take it.
To replicate all the details of her facial motion, we shoot packs with her to establish something that's an accurate model of her face and muscle movements and full kind of scope of emotions.
FACS is the facial action coding system developed by Paul Ekman.
He broke down all the muscle movements on the face, and we basically follow that system as our baseline for these characters.
There is somewhere between 50 and 100 poses that we typically collect. It gives us all the information we need to build like a facial puppet.
We had learned from Avatar the importance of incorporating the design of the actor playing the character into the design of the character if we wanted all of the emotion to come through. So we use Rosa's face as inspiration to ultimately evolve Alita's face into.
It's all about this. If you can make the audience believe that that character is real in a tight close-up.
Does it bother you that I'm not completely human?
You are the most human person I have ever met.
Alita, as conceived by Kishiro, has got these giant kind of manga eyes on a very kind of heart-shaped face to accommodate those eyes.
We saw the look of her and thought, we've never seen an anime, manga-type character with those eyes. Ever since Astro Boy in the 30s, we've never seen it photoreal in a movie.
Alita, with her big eyes and all of the special effects, she still feels more human than most of the humans who are acting in movies right now. Everything she feels just put right on her face.
Shh,
Yeah, right. So I'm 300 years old.
Sweetheart, you are.
Alita's eyes are an important part of her character.
The eyes, they were a bit of a yo-yo. We started with slightly bigger eyes than Rosa, and then we went to much, much bigger. And then we played with pupil size, we played with iris size, we played with moving them further apart, moving them closer together.
It's a little tricky because keeping the emotion intact as the actor intended, it can be a slippery slope. We have to strive on every shot, every scene, to try to look back to what Rosa was doing and bring it to life with as much commitment as she did on the day.
You know more about me than you're saying. Whose body is this? Who am I?
Her eyes, even though they're much bigger in Alita, they are Rosa's eyes, just scaled up. Her eyes are 1.25 times bigger than Rose's eyes.
Hi-ya! Her hair, it's very stylized, but we had to make sure that she could have this sort of unique look to her hair, but that it would still behave like real hair. So when you get to something like the Underworld fight, this is where it pays off.
What's the matter? My little toy doesn't want to play anymore.
We'll spend hours talking about the hair simulation. You look at Alita in the movie, you don't think that's not real hair. You think that's real hair. But that's not easy. And it doesn't always move the same way. When she's racing and the helmet comes off and there's wind blowing, all these different things. When we finalized the design of Alita, and we stepped back and looked at it next to the manga, we knew we had kept our commitment to Kishiro, to keep that character true to what he had created.
She's Rosa's Alita. She's not Kishiro's Alita. He's handed the baton to her, as you do. When you get the right actor for any role, it becomes their version of the character.
When I first saw what Alita was going to look like, it was crazy. It was a very surreal experience for me because every pull, every indent, every scar, every crease, things I wish they didn't put in are there. It's like looking at me because every little nuance of my face is there.
One of my big thrills was when she looked at those scenes and she laughed with joy and knew that that was her performance up on the screen.
That's so good.
It's amazing seeing Rosa's spirit, her light, come through the Alita character.
Rosa delivers a really nuanced, layered performance, and we're delivering photoreal digital performances on film, which is a new era of filmmaking, and I'm really excited to see that character on the big screen.
My hope is that when people are watching this, they sort of forget that she's a CG character.
She's just a character on screen. She's the same as Hugo. She's the same as all the other characters. Our CG can look amazing, but if our performance isn't there, it's never gonna work.
It's Rosa's performance. It's her and what she brought to it. It's her thinking, her emotions, and seeing it all finally come together has really been great.
You'd made the biggest mistake of your life.
What's that?
Underestimating who I am.
I think we've been able to create a seamless blend of live action and synthetic action in one single frame.
So are you stronger than you were?
Yeah, and faster too. It feels more me.
There's the great story of a very heartfelt character becoming a warrior. And this is the opposite of that. This is the warrior who has to find her humanity. And yes, I've got power, but what do I do with that power? Even though she could be so many other things, she chooses that part of her humanity to put forward.
I do not stand by in the presence of evil.
And it affects everyone.
That was pretty intense, huh?